So good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to Daughters of Eve, Challenging Fundamentalism in Pakistan, which, as I'm sure you all know, is being held as part of our public events and speaker series with the Women Peacemakers Residency here at the Joan B. Kroc Institute for Peace and Justice, part of the Kroc School of Peace Studies. My name is Jennifer Freeman, and I direct the program. Many of you are familiar with it, and it was started, as many of you know, by Joyce New and Dr. D. Aker 14 years ago here at the Institute. It now encompasses a network of 58 women from 38 different countries around the world. Many of you have had an opportunity to hear from the four women fellows that we have had here as part of the 2016 residency. Jane Anyango from Kenya, Fatma Mehdi Hassam from Western Sahara, Hamsatu Alamin from Nigeria, and of course today, Khurshid Bano from Pakistan, who we have the privilege of hearing from. Each of these extraordinary change makers have left their families and the important work that they are doing in their communities to spend 10 weeks here at the Institute, speaking to audiences such as all of you, working with undergraduate and graduate students in our War, Gender, and Peacebuilding class, and documenting the stories, challenges, and lessons of their work building peace and defending human rights in their communities. Each of these stories is documented through a process of daily interviews, which last usually between 2 and 3 hours. And they are undertaken with their peace writers. Our peace writers that we have in residence this year are Maggie Thatch Morshed, who has been working with Jane, Serena Pelka, who has been working with Fatma, Sue Diaz, who's been working with Hamsatu, and Alicia Wright, who has been working with Khurshid. This in-depth look into the lives and strategies of global women leaders will be released as an anthology of narratives in late January. For everybody who signed up for the event today through our Eventbrite site or when you came in, we will be sending you a link to the narratives when they are finished, and you will get to hear a lot more about Khurshid's work as well as our other peacemakers, starting from how they first recognized their leadership back in childhood, all the way through to how the conflict first affected them or why they choose to stand up in their communities and defend human rights or build peace. Our talk today features Khurshid and USD professor Bahar Davari discussing Khurshid's work and the impact of religious fundamentalism in Khyber Pakhtunkhwa, Pakistan. Pakistan, as all of you know, has featured prominently in the US media since September 11th, 2001. Its mountainous border with Afghanistan has become both a refuge for Taliban fighters and a thoroughfare for refugees fleeing violence during and following the US and NATO interventions. An association between Pakistan and terrorism was accentuated further with the assassination of Osama bin Laden in Abbottabad, Pakistan in 2011. The ongoing attacks by the Pakistani Taliban of a military barracks, was that yesterday, Khurshid? And prior attacks on lawyers, churches, mosques, and school children continue to keep Pakistan in the news, highlighting the violence that has plagued the country. Khurshid will indeed be discussing that violence today, both terrorist attacks perpetrated by the Taliban, but also the daily violence with which too many women continue to face in their homes and workplaces, especially in her native province of KP. However, she is also adamant that the media's near unilateral portrayal of Pakistan as a home of terrorism is incredibly harmful and misleading in its simplicity. The Taliban is estimated to have about 25,000 fighters, which I'm sure she could tell us more of. But Pakistan is a country of over 182 million people. The Taliban making up less than 0.1% of the population. And as Khurshid will tell you, Pakistanis are certainly not terrorists. They are much more often the victims and survivors of terrorism. Joining Khurshid today is Dr. Bahar Davari. Dr. Davari is an associate professor of religious studies as well as an affiliate member of the ethnic studies program here at USD. Her research includes feminist Islamic thought, the interpretation of the classical Islamic canon, as well as engagement with the concrete lives and social situations of women in various parts of the Muslim world. She has published widely in these areas and has written a book on women in the Quran. It is a pleasure for us to have two such esteemed speakers with us here today. Thank you both. Dr. Davari.
Thank you so much, Jennifer and IPJ and the Woman Peacemaker. It's a pleasure to be here, and thank you for all of you for coming, including my students from Exploring Religious Meaning and Islam class. Thank you all. I don't want to take much time because Khurshid has a lot to give us today. I only want to say point to one thing, in that my attention often is on religion. Anytime I send my students to Women Peacemakers to talk, I would ask them, what is the role of religion in this particular conflict? Because there are a lot of people who believe that religion per se is the only or the strongest role of to play in the conflict around the world. Others believe that religion plays a very strong role in conflict transformation. It is no accident that three of the Women Peacemakers this year are from Muslim-dominated regions. There is conflict in those regions, obviously. Some of you have heard those speakers. But I would like to point to the work of Lila Abu Lughat, a very short essay. She's a prolific author, but she has written a very short essay called "Do Muslim Women Really Need Saving?" in which she points out the idea that the administration of the time used the saving of Muslim women for the occupation of Afghanistan and the occupation of Iraq. When Khurshid talks about the Pakhtunkhwa woman, you'll see that it is the borderline with Afghanistan, as that militarization of the region have led to many of the issues that Muslim women have going through. Within religious studies, and particularly Islamic studies, Muslim women, whether secular, feminist, progressive, even traditional, they have been making attempts to challenge the oppressive rules, regulations, laws within their constitutions regarding women. They have had losses, they have had gains. Some of those have not been given as much credit as they should. And I think that is one of the purposes of the Women Peacemaker Program, to bring those to the foreground and to all of our attentions. So I'm grateful for that. Having said that, I think I better start asking Khurshid questions about her stories, particularly about the Hawwa Lur, daughter of Eve. But first I want to ask her a question about Pakhtunkhwa region. This is the name, by the way, given to that region, one of the four provinces in Pakistan very recently, in 2010. And that has been controversial itself. But I want to ask you, Khurshid, whether you could tell us something about the region, Pakhtunkhwa, and then the stories that you shared with me. It seems that you have been involved in peacemaking and women's issues from a very young age. What motivated you and impacted you to work in this peacemaking effort?
Assalamu alaikum. And welcome to all, and thank you, IPJ. They invite us and give a great opportunity to share the situation of my country and the Pakhtun women. And I would like to say, I'm sorry, I'm not a good speaker, English speaker, so pardon me. And one thing is more, in a 6 week, the English people not word the Pakhtunkhwa pronouns. So I am good. I'm speaking little bit good English. So pardon, please. So I want to share Pakistan. Pakistan has sixth most populous country. We have four provinces, Sindh, Balochistan, Khyber Pakhtunkhwa, and Punjab. Khyber Pakhtunkhwa is a near, share big border of Afghanistan. And in this cause of the many terrorism attack and many terrorists come easily in Khyber Pakhtunkhwa. And also the Pakistan is, Khyber Pakhtunkhwa is a big host city of the country. 62.1 million Afghan refugees accommodated in Khyber Pakhtunkhwa. And Khyber Pakhtunkhwa is a patriarchy and man-dominated area, but we have very, very rich culture, music, sitar, dance, atan, and beautiful love story, Adam Khan Durrani, Yusuf Khan Shirino, this type of very, the before of this attack, the Khyber Pakhtunkhwa called the land of hospitality, the land of flower. And the valley of Sawat is a beautiful valley called the mini Switzerland. May I invite you people, when they come, the terrorist and conflict finish, you must come and visit the Khyber Pakhtunkhwa beautiful valley and enjoy the fresh fruit and dry fruit. Thank you. Now I start my story. I believe that no one become a scholar or leader or a peacemaker in a day or some time. It takes you age to struggle to bring change in your society and to bring positive development in communities and mindset. There were many factors behind my work for the peace building in my region during my early age. Unlucky when I was born, within a year, the first war with India and Pakistan, 1965, is finished. So its impact in our area is bad, very bad, in fact. And when I am 6 years old, I saw in violence against women in my nearby. My father is a patriarchy system man and very tough behavior in with my mother, and I saw with my uncle and neighbor man is always beating and domestic violence in the women. So I always in a young age, I sit and I thought, what this happened and who changed this mind? Why the man has many more power in their hand, and women is why women are not speak out and complained against the men? So this time is I'm always put question for my mother, why you are not complained? But my mother was very calm and very polite woman. She asked, no, it's not a bed, it's our tradition. So I'm feeling happy, I'm not worried. After this 1971, the liberation war with India start. This war is also belong to the power because the Pakistani government and Yahya Khan and the Bhutto is not want to shift the power to Bangladesh PM. So this war, liberation war start in 1971. So this time is very tough time for the children and the women, because the evening time, all the blackout in this area, and for the protection, people make a fossa. And the women and children in the bombing time and the blackout time going to hidden in safety go the fossa. But this time for the children crying and feeling danger, and the women is also in the fossa look after their children. And the many children become ill physically and psychologically. So it's very dangerous. It's not a big war. It's a 13-day. So in the daytime, I sit with my younger sister, brother, cousins, and my friends, and I ask and I train, don't make a noise and cry in the night time. If you are not crying, we are safe. If you are crying, they bombing in our house. And going to the children and train how to use the fossa and how to save our life. These things is make me, maybe I'm not a big leader. I'm a small worker of the our community. So I feel I want to change all these things. And I put a question for my mother, who is make this conflict? Who is enemy? Why they bombing? Why they become this situation? So my mother always asked, inshallah, the days after soon change all these things. So these things, this factor involved me for the peacemaking and for the work for the violence against women. After this, I'm the survivor of forced marriage. My father not allowed to complete my education because my dream, when I'm always thinking, when I complete my education, I change all this society, norms, culture, and everything. But unfortunately, I accept this decision, but I achieve in a 4 year, I daily work with in a village with the community level women, and I change my husband mind. And after 4 year, we shift in Peshawar, and I request my husband, I want to start and complete my education. He was allowed me, and I start my education, and then I allow me to job in with the men's society. So it's the first women I'm complete my education, and I'm a first woman join the government job. And when I join the government job, there is many problem for the women worker. They have low wages, late time, sexual harassment, maternity leave, and even a separate common room and restroom. So I take part in a union election, and I got elect a first KPK working women, our union leader of Khyber Pakhtunkhwa. And I'm it's a not a work, it's my passion, it's my aim, and I want to change my community women lives because they also need to enjoy equal facility, equal opportunity in their region.
One of the hot topics of this election here in the United States is immigration. You mentioned the number of immigrants from Afghanistan to Pakhtunkhwa region. Since 2003, the fighting along with economic stagnation has forced hundreds of thousands of Pakistani women, particularly the Pakhtunkhwa region, men and children, to migrate to Karachi and the Gulf region. Karachi itself, with a population of 20 million, which includes about 4 million Pashtun, is a mini Pakistan. Very diverse in that regard. What impacts have the violence, forced migration, the general instability had on women in particular? What are the major challenges for the Pakhtun woman?
Yeah. The bad condition of peace and militancy has caused many problems in Pakistan. There were many hidden causes of war that include the loss of human life, loss of economics, loss of human rights. And generally, Pakistan has served a loss of 20-80 billion in war against terrorists from 2004, 2005, and 2008, and 2009, which badly affect in economic. Till 2014, another operation is start in Waziristan and other district of the federal Fata area. 1979, they start the the war in Afghanistan, and the Pakistan partner in US, American government. So it's not our war. It's the Soviet Union and the American war. But we are indirectly involved in this. And till 2016, we faced and we impact in this war. So in this time, the thousand of thousand Afghan refugee accommodate in Pakistan. And other is a drone, 9/11, after 9/11, drone attack start in the many Fatah area. So the migration of this area is also increased in the other districts. So the economy of the drone attack, when the drone attack in the Waziristan, the Taliban come and attack in the city area and capital area. Many factories, shops, market blown up. And the thousand of these girls' school is destroyed by the Taliban in KP. So the people, one thing more, the Pakistani labor, Khyber Pakhtunkhwa, Pakhtun labor is cost per day is $10 per day, for example. And when they migrate people come there, they take work on $2, the Afghan refugee. So the people refuse the local people and they take labor in the $2. So the economy and the unemployment is increase fastly. And other it is women schools, hospital blown up. So the women affected, more affected, 74% and 80% women and children affected. They become psychological and they become physical and disability is the 80% children and women. And they haven't any facility to go out and the restriction in their house. So the people of the Khyber Pakhtunkhwa migrate the big region and big province. Karachi is a big heart of Pakistan, Sindh, the province, Sindh city, big city. There have Gwadar port and many facility of job. Therefore, the people of want to go migrate there. And the impact in women is not change their behavior in Karachi and the region there because it's strict mindset people in there. So the nowadays, yesterday in Quetta is a big terrorist attack in the training center of the police training center, and our 61 young trainer is die and 160 is injured, seriously injured. It's a very big loss of the Pakistani people and the Pakhtun because of 19% of Pakhtun live in Quetta, Balochistan, and 19% in Khyber Pakhtunkhwa. We are losing many beloved people, property, and many things we lost. And therefore, maybe the Balochistan and Quetta people also migrate and other reason. And this is the big reason the people is migrate another regions.
As everyone knows, Pakistan, and particularly Pakhtunkhwa, is a male-dominated society, well, much like some other parts of the world, but sometimes stronger. Nevertheless, Pakistan have had strong women in its history. We all know Benazir Bhutto, who became the prime minister in the 80s and again in the 90s. We all have heard of Malala Yousafzai, who is the youngest recipient of Nobel Prize, the youngest laureate. What do you say about the role of this woman or other matriarchs in Pakistani society and among the Pakhtuns, which we haven't heard from? Of course, there are others like Abdul Ghaffar Khan, who was the friend of Gandhi in nonviolence, bringing unity to the region. So men and women in the region have been role models for bringing about peace. What impacts have their works had on your work and other women who are working on issues of peace?
First, I would say, every region, religion is very calm and peaceful. The religions and the conflict is a different thing. We have 1,24,000 prophet in the world. First is Adam and last is the Muhammad. And I read four books, holy books, but I never see they in every religion say to violence and make a conflict and restrict the women. I mentioned one hadith, our prophet, peace be upon him, said, seek knowledge and go if you're going to China. For the Muslimin, they not say only going for men seeking knowledge. And the religious mind people asked, they were blown up the school of the women because they asked, they mix religion and their own ideology. And other is the women of Pakistan and women of Muslim is a many big of example. Hazrat Khadija, the wife of our prophet, is a first woman, business woman. And the Hazrat Asha is a first coordinator, a political coordinator. We have many good examples, but the small group is only their own benefit. They use the name of religion. And other is the bad luck of the Pakhtun people, they ever used the name of the religion. And you mentioned Abdul Ghaffar Khan. Abdul Ghaffar Khan is a proud of our nation, Pakhtun. He was a very big leader of and the Khyber Pakhtunkhwa and very big name of the political leader. He was feel the Indian Hindu and Muslim is a different religion people. So this time they use the religions key. So make a separate country. The people are living and not, it's the not a time to live together. So they separate. And Gandhiji and these people. Nowadays, in 1978, when the Zia-ul-Haq dictator take the charge of Pakistan by the force, so they also used the name of Islam and they longer their government. Not they mind that the people don't know about the Islam. Islam is a peaceful and only believe on the love, not a terrorist, not a want a conflict. This is a small group only for their own benefit. So it's clear the religion is not involved in any conflict and any terrorist.
I wonder if you could also comment on Malala, who is a Pakhtun.
Malala is not for the Pakhtun proudness, is all over the world proud women. Because they, in this time, raised their voice and the all the hold in the valley. She is belong to Sawat Valley. In 2007 and 2006, all the valley under the control in Taliban. And they all the valley school and college and all the women activities is banned in this area because they are, the Taliban saw the women is out of their house, they shoot. And they very brutally they treat. So in this time, a very danger time, they asked about the against raise their voice, the Taliban, and spread the voice of for the education. So we are feeling very happy. And when they start their work, the more women come. The big group come front of the against the Taliban because they make power. Then her voice give a power on the other region women, And now the work is start in their region, little bit. So it's a very good initiative, and we are also take step to raise a voice and a strong hand together for our Pakhtun women.
Thank you. Can you tell us about your own work then, and Hawwa Lur, Daughters of Eve? The word Hawwa is Eve in Pashtun, in Dari, and Arabic. How do you counter fundamentalism through your work? We heard today that in Kuwaita there was an attack on police academy. At least 70 people were killed, several hundred injured. So this region continues to be a heavy frontier of the conflict. How does Hawwa Lur support the work of women and counter in a way these fundamentalist approaches?
The Hawwa Lur Pashto word mean the daughter of Eve. Hawwa. So 19% of the leadership is women. A majority of the women are survivor of violence, home-based worker, grassroots community women, and peacemaker. Our vision, a peaceful society where the women live with dignity, freedom, and development, and enjoy the equal right of life. Our mission, enabling the great target community to identify their problem and initiative, sustainable development progress, leading to the progressive way of living and improve capacity as a method by the which people can be assist to develop. I start the Hawwa Lur work in 1992 in this time. In the first time, we have only my two friends in this group and one of my sister and one my niece. We have only six women group. So there is a one group. We need a one group platform, so work for the violence against and women empowerment. After this, I make a group in a community level women, because the Benazir Bhutto, and you mentioned these things. So this is the very good women, very good leader for our Pakistan, but she is a high level woman. If we count in a finger tip, 3% of women, we have the ratio in the women in Pakistan, 48%. And the only 3% women is high level, and they have a power. They are a political leader, and the grassroots 75% women, people live in the rural area. They are not highlighting, they are not recognizing their work as a leadership, as a political, and anything. So we need to work more and make a big group, a strong group, to fight against this conflict and the violence against women. So we can start work, the name of the Hawwa Lur, not a big group. So we have 1,000 women members. We conduct, the Hawwa Lur is countering violent extremism in KPK. DHL's working is one of the most conflict affected province. We work promoting peace, conflict transformation, religious harmony, and the involvement of women in the peace building process, the strategies we used for the process of the building peace and involving women into aware campaign trainings, volunteer engagement, and providing services. The Hawwa Lur has more than 1,000 members a majority of them women, grassroots level women, youth is also girls, and youth is also a big majority of the active members. DHL conduct a serial of awareness program on TV, on radio. TV is not watching in many conflicted area because of fundamentalist mindset. We conduct transport, first time transport campaign on the road. Because the in Pakistan, education rate is very low. 30% only girls is going to school, and 17% women is out of school. So a need to aware people to change a strategy, because they only watching TV and ads and not reading a book. So we run a campaign in on the road, transport road, we call the Raksha project. So this on the all the public transport, we paste a picture and related gender, GBV and women related law to aware the common people. We aware train 900 people about the GBV and women related law. And we train the 500 youth about the conflict confirmations, because they people, this youth belong to the very affected area. Many of the boy is involved in with the small terrorist group. So they change their mindset. We are also involved the madrasa student, because the madrasa and the former education is very different. And the madrasa people, student considered we are illiterate and the other is modern. So it need to finish the gap in two mindset. So the first day is the people not free each other. Third day and final day, the people understand the religion is not make a conflict each other. So it's a very good work. And my big achievement is because I'm a first union leader, so always I work on the home-based worker and domestic and factory worker, because in Pakistan 20% the home-based worker ratio, and 12% is only women, because in Khyber Pakhtunkhwa women is not allowed to go out for working. So the women is sitting in their house and they working. I wear this all the dress, they make my home-based worker. So it's very good work. So 20% women, and they haven't a law and policy, and they're not recognized as a labor. So we are running a campaign. We want to make a law and policy for the home-based worker. And my greatest achievement, I make a first KPK working women union. It's only for women union. And we have 300 members, and we have conducted a training for the labor law, nationally and international law. 75 women we have trained about their law. And we have a legal aid center. We give a service for the victim of any type of GBV survivor. Free legal and psychological support. And also when the migrated people come there, 75% women affected. So we give a support like their document completion. When the people leave their house, they haven't ID card, haven't a marriage document. So we help to everything. It's a 20-year work. We haven't a time to mention everything. I want to, I wish you read my book, the documenting IPP, so it's you understand all the thing. Many many type of, we celebrate first time Holi and Diwali in Khyber Pakhtunkhwa. because sectarianism is increasing in this time. So need to spread harmony and faith and harmony to the people. We conduct several training program with the Islamic scholar and many other scholar of the religion. So it's very good impact to sit one table and conduct our training. Excuse me.
Thank you. I wanted to ask you to, if you can, tell some of these stories of interreligious bridge making that you do, whether it's with Pakistani Christians or Pakistani Hindus.
In Pakistan and especially in Khyber Pakhtunkhwa, three big regions, Parachanar, Kohat, and Banu, there is a majority of Sikh and Hindu. Peshawar is also a big majority. And before this attack, anyone know about this Shia, Sunni, Hindu, Sikh? But 1979, these things of start. So need to sit one table, and the people know about this conflict. I'm sorry. You are, the weather is not fit for me. Anything?
We're saying that until 1979, people were living peacefully, but something happened after 1979.
The, 1979, the Zia-ul-Haq is a very difficult and ideology is not Islamic, but they spread this thing. They make a Hudud ordinance in this time. They announce the Shia and Ahmadi is a kafir. It's non-Muslim. And before, the people is don't mention these things. So they, in a 40 days, the root is very strong. Need to finish the roots, not a upper tree. So the people is know, in the, if you question the young boy in the schools going, so they ask, no, it's he's a Shia, I'm a Sunni, I'm not sent there. So it's not good sign. Karachi and Balochistan, every time target killing the Hazarvi Shia people, because sectarianism, this thing is spread more and more. Need to work to the every states, people and religion, scholar sit together and spread in this confusion. Clear the confusion. We are living together. In our religion is a very big, big Islam, peaceful. The last, sorry, I mentioned the last khutbah, our prophet in the Hajjatul Wida. The name is Hajjatul Wida. The prophet, peace be upon him, openly said, all the people, black, white, language, Muslim, non-Muslim is equal because they count of their only humanity. If they do good work for the other, he is superior. Not a language, not Arabi, Ajmi, not the high position. Is a position for the their good work, the humanity work. So this clear, we live together. So this thing is very bad effect in the youth. So we conduct many trainings, many session about this topic.
I think I'm gonna ask you my last question and then turn it to the audience to ask questions. I wanted to know, how do you see the future of your work, either in Hawwa Lur or generally the future of women in Pakhtunkhwa, in Pakistan, and what are the efforts that locally, nationally, and internationally could lead to bettering the situation of women in the region, What can well-intentioned individuals in the West, for example, who would like to help do? Is it possible to help without full awareness of the complications and complexities of the issues, historical, political, and cultural?
Thank you, Bahar. Very good question. Because we are always discuss issue and problem, and we need to want some support. So first, I want to, in nationally level in Pakistan government, make a pro-woman law and give a space the women in political process. Many times, the political party offer me, come to join us. I refuse because of they give only name and they give only seat, but they not give me a power. So I not need a only seat and they announce she is a MNA MPA. No, no, I need power. If I have a power, I change my women's status. If I want a big car and on the flag car, so I going there. So no, I'm the grassroots community women. I know about the issue. I know the problem of the women. So first off, and we have very beautiful law in Pakistan, but implementation is in the zero. We struggle in the sexual harassment law. Sorry, I don't mention this. Many things, so it's mix up. In 2002 to 2010, we struggle the workplace harassment law, and we success in 2010. In a 6 year, I trained the people. I work on the awareness and the implementations. But in the 6 year, very small, and government and private department adopt this. So implementations and give nationally level to women involved the empowerment in political and based the first priority is education, because we have 1,000 school blown up. We need education. If the women is educate, if the mother is educate, all the nation become educate. So I believe it's my experience. My mother was not educated, but they give a very good training, love for all, not complaint each other. The many thing I repeat with Jennifer, any people, because I think they all the strategy use in my daily life. And internationally level, I request, I sit there in America, so I want and request, don't share the drone. Please, we not need the weapon. We are not support in the arm. We are want the school, colleges, health center, shelter home, and the women participation in our region. If you people want to invest in education side, invest to make a exchange program for the grassroots level people come there and seek knowledge. And I hope in 40 years, I'm not a disappointed. I hope I change. We are change maker. We are peacemaker. So invest, please invest in the benefit of the women, beneficiary of the education and health, because our women in the delivery time in a 1 minute, 500 women die in Pakistan because of lack of the hospital and women doctor, because the fundamentalist mindset people not allowed to go the men hospital. So these things I want, and we refuse the drone attack, after drone attack, the many problem create in Pakistan. The new group of Taliban spread and increase. So I mentioned the Quetta attack, the school attack, in every hour, every place is not safe in the terrorist attack. And last is Pakhtun and Pakistani people, is our are not terrorist. We are the victim and survivor of this war and conflict. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Khurshid. Thank you so much, Dr. Davari. Can we turn it over now for your questions, things that you would like to follow up on or hear more from what Khurshid and Dr. Davari have had to say? We have two mics at the back. If you could raise your hands, we'll ask some questions.
Hi. I am interested in hearing your perspective about day-to-day with trying to end polio in Pakistan. I particularly have heard about how when Osama bin Laden was being investigated, people posed as the purveyors of the polio vaccine. And so consequently, there have been bad times for some of the people trying to administer the polio vaccine. And so since you're in the trenches with a lot of the homemakers, I wonder what you're seeing at this point in time.
I'm sorry, I've not mentioned this point. In polio, worker is daily is only $3 when they work, and they haven't a safety of life. So many women in Khyber Pakhtunkhwa, in Mardan, Sawat, and Charsada, Noshera attacked, and they were killed. Polio is Pakistan is a five numbers country. In the anti-polio, the campaign is running, and the different mentalist mind not allowed to go and the children take this drop. The many myths, the popular, the American is give a medicine for the reproductive health. If the man is the child is take this and. After this, they not produce a children. It's open, and this is an un-Islamic. They mentioned this as an un-Islamic, this use, this thing. So many, and very big caused the people is killing polio worker, and the my group and the community people is women is trained going to door to door for the polio drop. But you mentioned the Osama bin Laden. I not comment in this topic because it's not clear. I'm not clear for there in this topic because we the people of Pakistan and not accept the Osama bin Laden in Abbottabad and dead in. And the Abbottabad in the place, so many people, the many opinion. So I'm not sure. So I'm not comment on this topic.
Dr. Davari, I wanted to follow up on that. Obviously, the fact that there is a religious narrative being used doesn't mean it's necessarily true. Your knowledge of Islamic canon, is there any mention that it is un-Islamic to receive a vaccination or anything?
Absolutely not.
I thought so, but thank you for confirming. Other questions in the audience? We have one over here. Thank you.
You mentioned that your husband was the first mindset that you really changed. Can you tell us a little bit more about how that came apart and how you use that strategy now?
First show this video, and then I explain.
Okay. Okay, let me see if I can.
के खिलाफ आवाज उठाने पर अमेरिका में चौथा मोहम्मद अली इंसानी हकूक का अवार्ड दिया गया
फिर ये अवार्ड एक्चुअली हर साल 6 लोगों को दिया जाता है 6 यंग लोगों को और पूरे एशिया से और फिर पाकिस्तान से मुझे ये अवार्ड दिया गया इस साल जो कि मैं यंगेस्ट अवार्ड विनर थी इस साल के
ये अवार्ड लेजेंड बॉक्सर मोहम्मद अली के नाम से मंसूब किया गया है पाकिस्तान सागा से बात करते हुए शोआना शाह का कहना था कि तकरीब में दुनिया भर से 2000 से ज़ायद अफराद ने शिरकत की
मुझे बहुत अच्छा लगा जब कहा गया कि शोआना शाह
दिस शी इज माय डॉटर एंड द बिग प्रूफ द माय फैमिली इज चेंज सो व्हेन आई एम मैरिड आई वाज मैरिड एंड गोइंग लिव इन द विलेज नोशेरा विलेज my in-laws is very Islamic and patriarchy system people. My husband is very educated and he is a teacher in a school. So I'm not complained anything. I'm thinking all the time. So I start a small school. For the home, the women working in their many sites. I asked before my husband, if you allow, I teach these women and this girl, they're going the other houses, domestic worker. So they need to aware about their rights because the nikah nama, our marriage documents want to sign in our region. But this woman is not understand the documents. So I every time I train these women. And with in a 4 year, I work all the house, clean house, and making a food, and every time work. And when I have a time, I search books and reading and this time. Then, and not say any gift and any cloth for my husband. And one time he sit with me and ask, you now need jewelry and this type of thing, and you not want to go mother house. I asked, no, my father-in-law asked, the women is not going all the time mother house. So it's okay, I'm feeling happy, not going. So the God give me opportunity. My husband is transferred in Peshawar main city. So they asked me, start the book in house, why you sitting there not working? So I asked, if you give me opportunity and allow me, I going to college and complete my education. So this proof, Shawana Shah is my daughter. My husband allow me to work with the men society. I going out, I'm there with the support of my husband. And first me and now my daughter work for humanity and they work in the grassroots. These areas, all the control of Taliban, we are going there. We are also under threat. They fire my car, they threat my family, but we are working. And this is a very good change. And after my husband, my brother-in-law, and my other family girls going college and now many girls is complete their masters in university is a big change. In my belief, first you change yourself, first you change your people, then go out and change all the people, all the society, all the country. And inshallah, I hopeful we have a very strong woman, Pakhtun woman, we change this.
Thank you. Down in the front.
Yeah, mine is not a question, just to make a contribution to that aspect of polio immunization and what women have done being Muslim women. In fact, Nigeria and Pakistan have similar, we work in similar contexts that kind of, what do I say? Negative religious perspective. In fact, some scholars But before I talk about the scholars, I want to point out that, honestly, the greatest enemy of not only Muslims, but the entire world face is the ignorant Muslim. The Muslim who now interprets the context of the text according to his ignorance, and then the whole world sees Islam and Muslim in what he does and says. So these kind of scholars now went propagating that America and the West are envying Muslim because of the rapid population growth. So therefore, devise this polio vaccine where some kind of substance is injected so that in the long term, our children will not produce. Hence, and so it is related to family planning, and that's how they propagate and then distort the mindset of people. So therefore, what we did, under my organization, the Federation of Muslim Women Association in Nigeria, it is an umbrella body with an outreach of all across the country with over 1 million Muslim women. So we then identified progressive Islamic scholars among the men themselves, and some of among us who are well-versed in the Quran, to come and go and make deeper research, to come out with any verse in the Quran or hadith that, in fact, that can substantiate this kind of assertion. And obviously, there was none. So we made these people now to go on radio, to speak on gatherings, to enlighten people, while we ourselves, being trusted Muslim women in the community, now, in fact, we led the vanguard of polio immunization in my country and family planning. So the vaccines are given to us. In fact, we follow from state to state, engaging with the local communities across the northern Nigeria, educating these women, men and the society that we are your fellow Muslims. We cannot do anything that will, in fact, harm you. See us allowing our children being vaccinated. And believe you me, we made an impact, and that organization is the leading crusader in this folio campaign. That we were given an award by WHO and then Melinda and Bill Gates Foundations for being the first to lead such a campaign. So you have to counter wherever there is this negative narrative about religion, you have to come up with a counter narrative and then educate the people on what really it is so that you disabuse their mindset, because ignorance is just rampant in our context. Thank you.
Question in the back.
Assalamu alaikum. I had a question about one of the facts that was in the slide that really stood out to me. It was that 97,000 psychiatric cases were recorded during the military occupancy, or the impact of the militancy in Khyber Pakhtunkhwa. Is there anything DHL does to aid those people that suffer those psychological problems?
I mentioned 62.1 Afghan refugee migrate in Pakistan in 1979. So till there, they have children and women. And I repeat, 75% women and children affected. And 2.5 million migrate in the IDPs, from Fata, Waziristan, Sawat, and other districts. They forced migrate in the other district because they start the operation against the Talibanization. So, you know, when they come, they haven't a vehicle in the mountain area. The night time the force announce leave the houses, we start operation because of the search the Taliban and group. So the people going on the walking in the four day walking distance in the other district. In the way, the women abortion, the women misplaced child and they were sexually abused on the way. And when they settle in the camps, there is not enough their need things because they're very huge people. And the city, modern and civilized people not want to accommodate these people because they are afraid if they are the group of the any people is group of the Taliban. This is all is question. So the three or four area is the registration point of the refugee. So they when they come missing, sexual harass, sexual abuse, the children and women, so they become a very confused and they have a physical and psychological problem. This is only registered case. You know, in Pakistan is a 1% case is registered. And the people of Pakistan not consider the mentally health is important. So this is the important cases. I have also lived with the, in a camp in Banu. I've observed the women, the need, the girls, young girls is need many things, and they are the majority of psychiatrist patient because they leave their houses, they leave their everything. So they are not just in their other area. So, and they, in the front of these children, they killed their parents, Taliban. They killed and they, you don't know, are not explain things. When I, one case is a girl, she is not speak in all the 15 days. So that my doctor, psychiatrist asked, she, maybe she then happened in the front of their behind is a very big story. So this type of psychiatry is a true registration, these cases. Maybe increasing more than 97,000. Yeah, I mentioned the Hawwa Lur team is going on the many camps and we live there and train the women, and we provide psychological support. We have not a big setup, but our team member and volunteer, we engage volunteers, so they make a group, and two doctor and two other girl sitting their camps, and the camps is a big city. So now we use the refer system also. The many organization work on this type of, so we make a network and use this strategy. Psychiatrists, we need psychiatrists there in this time. We have need in this time also. So the Hawwa Lur work in Banu, Waziristan, Afghan refugee, and many nowadays the Afghan refugees going back. The Hawwa Lur work with these women and documentations and registration and beneficiaries. One thing, in this time, when they start a Waziristan operation, is the very difficult procedure of the check and cash and other thing. The government announced the mobile set and they give a code number. You know, the women is totally illiterate. They are not how to use the mobile, and they are not read their name. So this time they need to help. So our team go there and train the how you use the mobile, where the code, where you go in the camp sites, and we provide a service this type of also.
So they're using mobile phones to do the registration in the camps?
No, the mobile phone is one code. They family register in the camps, the office, and then they 25,000 Pakistani rupees one family they give benefit. So the very complicated because the people. All the people, men, women, is not how to use mobile, and they not read. So the team is going there and asked when the message you receive in the mobile, you confirm. And then you show this code number of this the counter, and you receive the check. Because there are many corruption in this way, so the for the corruption taken and counter the corruption, the, this method introduced in Pakistan. But not useful, the women is not receive this type, the people is misused and check the code number and apply the for the benefit. So it's not a good, I think the people is not used easily this code and these things.
Another example for my students in war, gender, and peacebuilding to consider how the absence of a gender analysis in designing a solution might have detrimental effects. Thank you, Khurshid. Any other questions? We've got one here, one here, one here.
Thank you, Khurshid. Nice to see you again. Corruption has no gender, and many women in power have been mired in corruption charges, and I was wondering, including, I think, Benazir Bhutto, what did she do for women as she was when she was leading your country, and how, going forward, will you ensure that the women that come to power, hopefully eventually, to help solve some of these problems, will be less tainted?
First, I'm going to translate your question in Hindi. वो कह रहे थे कि बेनज़ीर भुट्टो जो पावर में थे जब, तो उन्होंने विमेन के लिए क्या किया, और उनके सामने भी करप्शन के काफी इल्जाम थे कि खास करके आसिफ अली के साथ. तो आप लोगों ने उससे क्या सीखा है कि जब विमेन फिर से पावर में आए तो ये सब चीज़ें ना उलझे?
Thank you. When the Benazir Bhutto come back in Pakistan in 1988, this time is in 88 die this Ziaul Haq in plane crash. So she is out in Pakistan. Then they come back in Pakistan and take part in an election. She is a very good lady, very big political leader, but unfortunately, the people of patriarchy system not complete their time period. 5 year time, they not complete. In within 2 years, they finish their government. She introduced many beautiful law. One law is maternity leave. In Pakistan, only allowed 2 baby and without pay. So they introduce and they are the open. It's the open if the women want to deliver 5 to give with pay. In only a government department, not a private. Private is a very difficult. The 2 days not leave allowed the women. So they introduced the Benazir card. It's a very good card, the grassroots women, the support card, card the Benazir supporting card. So it's a very good initiative. But corruption is the side of their husband, Asif Ali Zardari. Yesterday we are also discussed on this. Pakistan political is a very dirty political peoples and not a good politics. The 2 families always on the rule. Bhutto family, Nawaz family. Bhutto family and Nawaz family. We reject, but we need to polish the grassroots leader. We have many leaders. For example, now the Imran Khan is have a very good policies, very good thinking about the nation. They have in power in Khyber Pakhtunkhwa. Pakhtun people give select Imran Khan, but the federal government is not giving a free hand to implement this good work. So political game need the in Pakistan money game. all the, if the Khan and the system is a Khan, Vadera, Malik, and his son, her son, and his daughter. Benazir is the big political leader daughter. Wali Khan, Naseem Wali Khan is the Ghaffar Khan daughter-in-law. And this thing is everything circling in the big family. If we want, if you want, maybe if you want, we want, all the people want change, they give a participation in the grassroots and the community people. Because 75% live in the rural area, illiterate. They have many problems. They're facing many problems. And not anyone sit in the big seat, not discuss the problem of their people. One time, the budget speech, and I'm there. So the big leader in women, in Karachi women, they asked the question, how the rate of the flour and sugar. You know, I don't know about this. So I question, you going the budget speech and you don't know about our issue? Oh, very sad. So we need to change our mind and the people.
Two more questions down here. Okay, great.
Okay, so you mentioned that you do these training programs and you're trying to empower women to kind of take control of their problems in their community. So can you talk about that a little more? How do you get access to women in these rural areas to be engaged in these training programs? And once the Hawwa Lur leaves these communities, how does the work continue after the training programs? How are the women involved?
You know, I first mentioned the Hawwa Lur, the 19% of leadership of women, and women is a grassroots and community level. We make committees, a citizen committee. Name is a citizen committee. Every the districts and every the village, and this is the five women committee. One is a focal person, and other is a helper. If we are trained these women about their rights and everything, if they have any problem, they sit together and discuss. If they not solve their self, they call the Hawwa Lur office and ask, we need lawyer, we need any other things, because then, we handle a very big violence against the case, asset throwing case. So the women inform us the asset throwing case is there and the not case registered. So this is very affected. And we mentioned the mother of, we target the mother, because the mother is know about the children activities keenly and observe everything. So very good effect. Many women disclose the relation of their children with Taliban. So we counter, easily counter and train this man and change their mindset. So it's before the common people and the big level people easily not going to the affected area, because the people is not trust and not allowed to go there. So we use many strategy, make a network in the local peoples, and then we going there easily.
Any final question? Oh, okay. One last burning question.
My question is not related to your purpose and organization. I have a general question. I'm wondering if I'm taking the audience time. But I my question is about the psychology of the region. Yeah. Would we have time for that? Okay. One thing I would like to know, for us in the Western world, when we look to the region, whether Afghanistan and Pakistan, even Iran, that's where I'm from, why do we see the anger? I travel sometime, and one thing that I realize in the For me, sometimes the question comes in, what is the anger behind all these conflicts when it comes to conflicts with Taliban, when it comes with whatever is going on in Iran, and also I have seen it in Pakistan. What is the psychology behind the anger in the region?
First thing I mentioned, if the people not enjoy the equal rights, and the as a psychiatrist, I think it's become an anger. For example, I mentioned the madrasa student and the English students is sit there, and the madrasa student wear a cap, and the religious type dresses, and the others, the English student laughing in there, and they laughing in there. They reject each other. And they, when I sit with the madrasa student, they ask, they tell me, these people enjoy the big institute. They have any facility. They gaming, they watching TV, and they have money, they enjoy cars. And this situation, the two type of people and two type of education is give the people and the hate, and they give many things, roots is come there. So the religion is not count, because this is only norm and culture. Culture is for our betterment, but they misuse people. Religion give a free hand. Our anger is always everywhere spread and increasing if the people is not give you the equal right and discriminations. For example, when they start drone attack, the people of the Taliban make a strong group and attack in the capital city and ask, you are sitting in easily, and our children and die, innocent children die every day, and we have migrate our city, and we have abortion of our women, and why you are sitting easy and sleeping? So this is anger. They come and attack in Peshawar, schools, colleges, hospital, mosques, and church is a big example. And development and education is very must. They know their religion and they not read properly Quran Majid. If they understand their the teaching of Islam, so they not become anger. And education is very must. They totally people is uneducated to need to education and development.
Okay, thank you. If I may, there's a portion of segment on TVs that I have seen, and there's in villages, not in major cities. There is a new structure. When I was growing in Iran, we didn't have that. In villages, they're training anger. And I want to know if you noticed that in the villages. Basically, what I have seen, to be more clear, the teacher would stand two students to slap each other. And at one point, they became very violent. And this started from in a very rural area, and I have heard that happens in Afghanistan, it happens in Pakistan, but for boys' schools, not girls' schools. So do you see those kinds of specific training in your region? It's something that you can do, because for me, when those boys grow up, they become violent, husband violent, brother violent, sister. So I wanted to know if you have seen that in your region.
No, if you have seen in any village schools, teachers telling the students, the boys, to slap each other?
It's a very common. In madrasa student, the teacher is treat very hardly, it's very big complaint. And now the Khyber Pakhtunkhwa passed a law, if the teacher slapped and treat this type, so the punished, and the other thing is also. The madrasa is a very good institute of our Islamic center and the study of the Islamic things. But they nowadays they misuse. We want madrasa, but we request our country to check and balance in this madrasa what type of question and what type of the studies these books. So they check and balance it. And the poverty line is very, poverty is very high in Pakistan, in especially in Khyber Pakhtunkhwa. I mentioned very economic collapse and very thing. So they have, the children is, every man and woman have 10 and 12 children. And they not afford to admit in a public school and another. So they give a 4 and 3 children in the madrasa. Madrasa responsible, the boarding, housing, and everything. So when I question why you admit 4 children in madrasa, so they ask, it's easy for me. They give them food and everything. So I am not afford this. So they not take a check and balance what they do their children, because they attack on Taliban attack in the 8 year to 15 year children. Their mindset change. So it's a good law in Pakistan, maybe implemented. Implementation is very slow in. Yeah.
That's, I think, a very good explanation, first of all, for the pressures that parents are under and the role, the development and social role that madrasas play. I'm interested to hear, Dr. Davari, if you have anything to add. I would throw out that while that may be an extreme example, I think it raises for me the ways in which we train violence or violent masculinities for our boys in particular in many societies around the world. I can think about how that is supported here as well. Was there anything you wanted to add to that, Dr. Davari?
Well, only in response to the last question, that to imply that a certain people are psychologically more prone to violence or train their children to violence, I think would be at best simplistic, and not having in mind the political, historical, cultural situations that these countries have been going through. In the borders that you saw in the map that Khurshid had in the beginning, she showed that Pakhtunkhwa region is borderline with Afghanistan. Afghanistan had been occupied in all of the 70s by Russians. Before that, of course, colonization in the region, the idea that whatever the British treaties implied was inherited by Afghanistan or Pakistan, and where does this area that is Pakhtunkhwa belong to, which is something that came out in the talk given by Fatma as well about the Sahrawi woman with the fight between Morocco. So these issues have deep-rooted causes within the colonial legacies of the region. And of course, they have been militarized for the past at least 40 years. So to say that there's something about the psychology of the Pakistani or the Iranian or the Afghan that is rooted more in violence, I think would be highly simplistic.
Thank you. Very, very good addition. I wanted to thank both of you. Dr. Davari, all your perspectives, I think, have greatly added to this conversation. And Khurshid, of course, thank you so much for giving us such a deep and nuanced look at both the challenges that you are facing, that women are facing, that the region is facing, and both the local, national, and international roots of some of those challenges. I think many of us having received more simplistic understandings of what the dynamics might be, have a lot to learn. B, can be overwhelmed by just the depth and complexity of the challenges. And so what I really take away from the opportunity to hear you is that you and hundreds of women who you work with don't take the luxury of being overwhelmed or apathetic. You have been working on these challenges for decades, and you continue to work on these challenges. And I think that is an inspiration and a lesson for all of us, that peace, as you often say in the classroom and to audiences, is made piece by piece. And that is really the only way we go forward, is making that progress piece by piece. As this is our last public event in the Women Peacemaker series, I do want to say thank you. I want to say thank you to Cigna Healthcare for being such a staunch supporter of this Women Peacemakers residency. I want to thank, of course, Dr. Davari and all the discussants from the University of San Diego that we've had over this series to add. I want to thank my colleague, Katie Zanoni, who is the program officer for the Women Peacemakers Program and who has been managing the residency all year. She puts in countless hours to facilitate Khurshid and the other peacemakers and peace writers' time documenting their stories, as well as all the public events they do. Thank you for our incredibly helpful translator for stepping in and assisting us with the language barriers that inevitably come. And I want to thank everyone here, both everybody sitting in this room and everybody watching online. The Peacemakers had an opportunity to meet with the university president, Dr. Harris, yesterday, and he was asking, you know, what have people been asking you? What kind of questions have been coming out? And not only did the Peacemakers share what some of the great questions each of you have been posing to them, but they also shared how much they are learning from the different groups and audiences that they've been able to engage with while they've been here at the University of San Diego at the Kroc School of Peace Studies and the Institute for Peace and Justice. So thank you for taking the time out of your days to come here and listen to all of the peacemakers, including Khurshid today. It has been a pleasure and an honor. Thank you.
Thank you for all listening to me and sharing my all the situation of my region, Khyber Pakhtunkhwa. I know in that after 10 weeks, you pronounce easily Khyber Pakhtunkhwa.
I'll keep working, Khurshid. Thank you.